Fourth Stringers.
And today we have Chris Paluca. And if you're wondering,
Paluca, wow, you said it right the first try. Yeah, dude.
I'm about to say, if you're wondering how I said it right the first time, it's because I just practiced it 17 times in my head.
Yeah.
This is kind of a confused
I'm still practicing.
Episode.
I can't get it.
We weren't sure if we were recording a podcast in the morning or at night.
Yeah.
I texted Fabian. I was like, hey, you want to hit up John? And then he's like, no, you should hit him up because I elbowed him like 8 times in training today. And I was like, oh, he's definitely not coming.
It's not that. Like, dude, like, imagine, like, you have somebody who you think has, like, all the answers. You just constantly want to ask them questions. You're just like,
yeah, I'm like,
how
do you reach the top shelf?
You know? How do you... And it's stupid too, because it's sometimes it's shit you already know. And like, I'd say like for jiu-jitsu, like the best answers are the most simple ones. So he literally tells me like the most, like sometimes I'll ask him like the, like, I don't know, man, like the dumbest shit. And then he just gives me like the simplest answer. And I'm like, well, already knew that, but thanks for reaffirming it. I'm just fucking
man, fuck
retarded.
John.
All right, so yeah, sorry.
Keep... So no.
Yeah, who
works out.
Who is this guy next to me?
Yeah, so Chris, you're a purple belt under Jon Calestine and Daisuke.
Yeah, pretty much.
Am I saying his name right?
Daisuke
Yamaji?
Daisuke Yamaji.
Yamaji. Yeah.
You said that completely wrong.
Yeah.
Should have practiced that 17 times.
I got to practice that one. I just saw his Instagram name because I just started following him after hit that glorious story.
How funny was that shit?
So that was hilarious.
Funny. Yeah. So you got your purple belt under Daisuke and John,
Dice
right?
And John, yeah.
Nice. And how long ago did you meet John?
I imagine
the whole podcast is about John, just through Chris.
Yeah, right?
Yeah. So
this is the John interview, yeah. Just through
So
me.
When John makes his oatmeal, does he like it thick or does he like it like run?
So,
asking for a friend, asking for a friend.
But
No, so you started training how long
I mean,
ago, Chris?
I started an MMA gym like a little over 4 years ago.
What was
like
your awesome MMA gym's name? Mine was Extreme MMA.
It was just Brooklyn Mixed Martial Arts.
Oh, whatever. Oh, okay. You guys are professional. Whatever.
Yeah, I mean,
cool.
When I started there, that's kind of... started there. I was there for a year, but it was very on and off. Like, sometimes I wouldn't show up for, like, a month. I would train, like, once a week, maybe. So it was very...
Were you
just
doing just jiu-jitsu or were you
pretty
doing
pretty much.
MMA?
I would show up occasionally to MMA class if I wanted to train extra that week, but they had one day gi, one day no gi, and I never did the gi, so... Kind of
have you just
really train.
Never trained in the gi?
Like once.
Do you own a gi?
I think I have one in my closet.
Is it a judo gi?
No.
Like the one that you get when you
it's
sign
a,
up
it's
to
an
like
actual
UFC gym and shit? No offense,
baby. It's a jiu-jitsu gi, but I like barely trained, and I never tried. I trained the gi once, maybe twice. But I just didn't like it. And I'm like, I just want to do no gi.
You should just jump in like a gi open for like IBJJF New York Open and like the gi. You're like,
and like I met Kaplan there, Elon and Bert, and then. Like, Cap, like that's kind of how I came to Renzos.
Zombie
Kaplan
Bert?
And Alon. Yeah, Bert. Yeah, yeah. That Bert. That's kind of how I came to Renzos. Like, after my year was up there, I had, like, a discount. Like, they did, like, a student sale or something. And I got, like, $900 for the year. And then they're like, all right, you have to pay full price now. I'm like, it's basically the same as Renzos. I just want to do jiu-jitsu, so I'm not staying here,
yeah.
Which was a great decision. I've been at Renzos for, like, 3 years now. And,
nice.
Renzo Brooklyn's where I started. I started with Daisuke, Kaplan, all those guys. Alon trained at night mostly. And it was still like on and off like 3 days a week. And then Kaplan started teaching at Pure Heart. So I started going there. John started teaching at Pure Heart.
How long ago was Pure Heart? Pure Heart was in Astoria, right?
Yeah. I want to say like close to 3 years ago, they were teaching there for like 2 years. Like I go train there. I go train at Renzo Brooklyn like twice a week at night. Then eventually I started training in the city. I trained there for like a year and a half for the noon class with like Danner, Eddie.
Yeah, yeah.
But like I started going there.
Around what time were you going there?
I want to say like 2 years ago.
Yeah.
Like maybe a year into being at Renzo's, maybe a little less. Like,
that's when it was still popping. Like the
like,
squad was still all together and like
yeah,
everyone
was like
training
kinda
together.
Yeah, that was kind of when Gary and Eddie were at like, they
peak?
Were just like, yeah. I mean, not the peak I would say, but like when they were like, just getting like all the attention, and they were like, when Gary was
that
like,
must have
going
been awesome
to
be around.
And then,
yeah.
Like, Gordon wasn't even like, no one knew who Gordon was at that point. Like,
he was like
kinda,
skinny still at that
he
point.
He was like, I think he might have just got his brown belt when I started going there.
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
Before he won, like, he was winning like local stuff when I was going there, he, like the Grappler's Quest and all that shit.
Maybe you got to that academy as a white belt, though, right?
I went a few times as a white belt, and then, like, with John Danaher's noon class, like, I didn't really go. up until like I was a blue belt. I think just when I got my blue belt, which I was a blue belt for a while, like over 2 years, I think. Mm-hmm. But that's when I started going there. It used to be invite only, like I was telling you earlier. And there was like 15 people who did no-gi, and then it was a gi class. So I kind of, like, I would take Calestine's morning class at Pure Heart at like 9 a.m. Mm-hmm. Then he would go to the city and train, but like I didn't want to just jump in because I felt like I don't want to be disrespectful.
That respect, yeah.
Yeah, like, so I would sit on the side and, like, wait, because we used to go from 9 a.m. Pure Heart, go to the city for noon, which wind up starting, like, close to 1, and then go back to Pure Heart, hang out for a little bit, and then train at night again.
So you guys are, like, neighbors?
Jon lives, like, a few blocks from me, mm-hmm. but I didn't meet him until, like, Renzo, Brooklyn. Like,
wow, that's such a small world.
We went to the
world.
Same middle school for, like, 2 years, and, like, I'd definitely seen him before, but, like, we didn't know each other
you
like that.
You saw him? Dude, you're, like, so much taller than him. Like, what do you mean? Yeah, I can't imagine, like, a seventh grade fucking Calestine. He's, like, what the hell?
I wasn't tall, like, my whole life, though. Like, I didn't, yeah. like, I was short. Like, yeah, I was, like, 5'2" in, like, freshman year.
Oh, so you were right there with Calestine.
You're 5'2" freshman year in high school?
That's wild, dude.
So what, did you just start eating horse meat or something?
Nah, I just, like, had a random growth spurt throughout high school. Like, I would grow, like, 4 inches, like, every year.
Oh, my God. Shit. Where's my hormone?
How tall are you now?
Where?
6'1". So let me introduce you to one of the wizards of the Shire.
Yes.
So, yeah, if you guys are wondering,
but
Chris is one of the residential wizards of the Shire.
There's, like, three of us.
Yeah, there's not a lot of tall people.
It's, like me, Rao, and Quinn.
Yeah. Yeah,
like,
I'm
the shittiest wizard of
and
all.
Elon, and, like, Elon.
Somehow Elon's still a cop in the Shire.
Like, yeah, he's a cop.
I'm like, yeah.
We need one.
Yo, we just one. Completely went
we're
off
like,
track.
Elon, yeah, Elon is, like, that dude would be the worst undercover cop, man.
Dude, you can smell he's a cop. Yeah. Like, you just look at him and you...
And he's such... I love that dude. That dude's my homie.
Yeah, he talks so much
shit.
If
he was an undercover cop, like, he'd show up and he'd probably say the dumbest shit. He'd be like... How about them police officers, huh? Really tough job.
Fuck the police, huh?
He'd be like, nothing but respect for those young gentlemen and everybody.
Yeah, he's Russian. No. Their people are spies.
Yeah,
he's
he has to be a spy. Yeah, his name's Elon, you know?
Elon.
He says he's Jewish. Never, ever once seen him even...
He's never had a yarmulke in his bag.
Yeah.
I've never seen that.
He's like, oh, he loves Trump. Loves him. You know? He swears he's 176 pounds. He swears he's
like,
going to be so busy. He actually listens to
He goes,
he's like, I'm not 170. I never said that. Yeah. I'm 200 pounds.
The first time he ever came to ITC, man, I'm pretty sure. And somebody else said that they heard him say it too. That I was like, how much do you weigh? And maybe he said 178, but I'm pretty
sure
he said 176.
That was like,
and I looked at him and I was
that was
like,
less than a year ago. For sure, it was
no
not.
No way, this dude.
Wow.
Who's strong as shit? And to this day, he denies it. But he also denies
the
parking ticket in the school zone. So I don't believe him.
Yeah.
He's so strong.
He's a spy, dude.
He'll literally grab my ankle from just like a warm position, and I'm like,
he could take a 2-on-1 on my wrist and pull me into a triangle, like effortlessly.
Yeah.
So annoying. He's just
those
so
grips.
Strong. It's like, fuck you.
It's that Russian grip,
bro.
And he holds.
Yeah. He's gonna be so pissed.
Like,
stop
resisting. I'm like, dude, I'm
like,
not moving.
Stop telling everyone I'm a cop.
Yeah. That's
it's like, dude, it's not us, dude. You're the one. It's just you.
Like,
that's your identity.
It's literally the everything that tells you that you're.
Yeah.
Anyway, I'm gonna get this thing back on track because we just like completely went off.
Wait. Before that, he DMs me, so I put a picture up of the Shire. He's like, "Where's my tag?" So I fucking the next picture I put up is him being mad Jewish with fucking Calestine on his shoulders, and then I send him a DM. I do @ and then I do a pig emoji. And he's fucking like, fuck you.
Yeah, you deserve that.
That's just, all right, back on track.
Where the fuck was I? I think I was, yeah, so like I would sit on the side and like watch them train for like at least like a month. And then
that's wild.
They were
that's commitment.
Like, yeah, I just wanted to learn. And like I was just sitting there. I didn't want to be disrespectful. And I was also too scared to ask Danner if I could jump in the class because I'm afraid he's going to be like, no, you're retarded. You're not doing this class.
Yeah. He's like, no, I don't like your rash guard.
Yeah, so I think what happened was they were doing like an 11 a.m. like it was like a no-gi comp class for Worlds, and Taza and Nikki were doing it just to get extra training, and they're like, oh, come like do this with us, you can come do it. So I did that for like a few weeks. They didn't do it for very long. I did that, and then I would text Nikki, are you going, like, you're gonna train?
Uh-huh.
And he was just like, dude,
just
come to noon. So come. Yeah. I'll ask Gordon if it's okay, and Gordon said it was cool. So
wow,
like I started going. I was like the worst person in the room basically when I went. And it was, I mean, it was like a stacked room, and it was basically no guests were really allowed in. Like, some people would just come in. John wouldn't really say anything because they mm-hmm. were going to come for a day, and like people would just beat them up and they'd never come back.
Yeah, yeah.
But it was never like all the gi people could just decide they want to do no gi. Like, you have to be invited.
Wow.
So it was like Gary, Gordon, Eddie, Frank, John, Kaplan,
Nikki,
Taza, Ethan. Like, Jesus, the room was just stacked, and like my rounds every
Quinn
day.
Was there too?
Quinn was there.
Shout out to Pizza Jitsu.
Like,
Wizard.
I think a few people started coming later. Like, Ethan started coming more consistently later on. Rao started coming. Ronan started coming. Like, that was like maybe like 6 months later when those guys started coming. Mm-hmm. But when I was there, like, I would get the shit kicked out of me every day. Like,
I can't imagine, dude.
Like, there was no one there like close to my level, aside from like maybe like Drew. Like, he was like the only other blue belt there. Yeah. Manny at the time was a blue belt, which, I mean, Manny's strong as fuck. So
it's he's a freak.
Ridiculously strong.
Like, that being like that worst person in the room, you put those people, those same like people in the room again, we're all still like the worst person.
Oh,
in the
room. But like, that's felt such like crazy. I finally like started getting like catching up a little bit, because I was like so far off where like everyone was just fucking me up,
tapping you.
And then it was like, all right, like I'm starting to actually like hang with some of these guys, even though they're still better than me. It's like, all right, I'm only getting tapped once now. And like, I was getting tapped by someone like 5 times, and then like 6 months later, whatever, I was only getting tapped by them like once in a round. It was cool. Like, but that room was just ridiculous at the time. And then, I don't know, it kind of just started getting like weird, and started like just everyone was allowed in. And it just, I don't know, John didn't like training with this competition every day. And Eddie kind of was like, didn't like that also, that like, because people wanted to compete like in the same tournaments, and there was no structure to the room. Like, they were just like, all right, this person, like, I don't know, it's kind of like favoritism in a way. It wasn't the best guy, because to me, John, aside from Eddie, was the best 45er in there, like, by far. Like,
really? By far?
Yeah. Like, 100%. Like, like, I trained with all these guys. Like, they're very good. All of them?
Yeah.
Very good. Eddie was number one at 45, but then it was John, and then to me, it was, like, a gap, and then everyone else. Like, there was a gap between John and Eddie, and then there was another gap, and then it was, like, Frank, Ethan, Nikki, and like, not in that order, but like, just
those like at that time though, because like, I mean, I'm sure everybody's gotten like way everyone's like such a monster competitor out of that.
No, they're all great.
Frank just got his black belt and murdered some.
Like, I love all those guys. Like, 0.7
seconds.
I'm never gonna talk badly about them.
Yeah, but that's what the hierarchy was at the time.
Just being realistic in like the eyes of who I was training with. Like, I was training with all of them, and like my training partners every day. Like, it was consistent for a while, where it was John, Frank, Ethan, Damien, and then like one other round I would do like with whoever.
Wow.
But that was like,
that's a hard
it was a hard day. Like, there was no easy rounds there. But like, and then Eddie, like, I would train with, or Gary, like, here and there. Like, it was just whatever. But there was always just, to me, it was always very obvious that John was after Eddie. Like, when Eddie was stopped doing 45, or if there was a spot open at 45, it was John's. It wasn't like.
Did John put in the most time out of everybody, or was he just the best skilled?
He was like the most time in how long he's been training, or
I feel like the way they give spots at the Death Squad, or like even in most teams, is like who has the most time in it, seniority.
I mean, no, for sure. Like, in terms of like that room, like, I wasn't there from the beginning. I was there like a year after that, like, comp class started, like, the no-gi thing. But from everything I've heard, it started with Gary, Eddie, Kaplan, Atavia, and JC. Like, those were, like, the first people there.
Eddie, Kaplan, Atavia. Wow.
And then, like, other people started coming. Like, I know Frank was there a little bit after. I don't know, like, the time period of everything, but I know those were, like, they were there at the start. And, like, Gordon and Frank and them started coming a little later.
Yeah.
Nikki eventually started coming. Nikki was kind of coming like just a little bit before me, because he was still like 15. Like, he was young, maybe even like 14, 15. Like, so Nikki was like not there yet. Honestly, John, for every reason, should have been the person getting the spots. Like, it was kind of like, it wasn't like he wasn't able to do anything because someone else, but it was like anyone could jump in. There was no structure. Like, honestly, like, I'm doing the ADCC in-house at Match Gym, even though, like, that's not my main place of training.
Where's your main place? Isn't it Hensel, Brooklyn?
It's Hensel, Brooklyn. Yeah. Like, the comp training every day. But at the same time, like, to me, it's like, all right, like, I'd rather there be some sort of structure. So it's not like six people are jumping in at the same weight class and we're going to have to face each other first round anyway. Like,
oh, yeah, yeah. Like, what's the point in that? But if you put in your same team name, like, don't they avoid matching you?
No, with ADCC trials, they, like, match those people up and put them on the same side if you put the same team name. Unless there's two people, then they'll, like, kind of put them on opposite sides or whatever.
Uh-huh.
But if it's, like, six of you, they're like, all right, well, you guys are going to have match, like, all second round or something.
So what are these brackets
looking
like?
Oh, my heart, dude.
What are these ADCC poncho trial MMA brackets looking like?
Dude, my heart just dropped when I heard that. I'm like, yo, like, there's so many monsters from the Henzo Association. And, like, just going into ADCC, it's just going into that first round is going to be trials, fucking hell,
I mean,
dude.
I don't know entirely. Like, for me, like, I would just put down Shire, BJJ, just like I did with Grappling Industries, just because, like, whatever. Like, I'd rather, like, just do that. It would be, like, I don't know. It's just easier. And I could put down Henzo Gracie Fight Academy, too, if I have to be, like, in association with someone. Like, I could put that down, too, but I feel like they may still match me up with certain people.
Yeah.
Just because it's Henzo, whatever. But I feel like just everyone from Henzo is going to do it anyway. But the in-house,
at the end of the day, the trial is just like, it's so insane, man. This
It's
so insane. It's just like, whatever, man. Let's just show up first and we'll figure it out there.
Yeah, yeah. Like, I don't know. It's not up to me, like, to decide the bracket. So I'm just going to show up.
Yeah.
Hopefully weight.
I'd love to show up, like, and just do it. Like, I have no problem making 45. I walk around, like, 52. I can get a little heavier.
Damn it, 6'1".
I mean, I walk around like...
You should be president now.
It's easy for me to make 45, but, like, I understand, like, wanting to do an in-house just so it's not like, all right, all of us are going to do it, but, like, at the same time, it's only, like, three of us who actually want to do it. The other two are just like, yeah, we'll do the in-house, like...
Just to, like, do the in-house.
Yeah, it's, like, two of the blue belts, and, like, it's two of the blue belts from Match Gym. Chris Mendoza is a good purple belt. Tim, who trains in the city and trains at Boncho with John in the morning... He's doing it, and I think maybe one of Matt's purple belts. It's like six people.
Cool.
Which I'm cool with doing the in-house, but at the same time, it's like they're not doing, like, even weigh-ins. So I'm like, I mean, everyone competes
so
at like
they
45,
come in
55,
heavier. Yeah.
But I'm like, I know there's like one or two people who are like 160 right now, and it's like, all right, well, I'm like 150. Like, you should at least have to be under 55 or something.
Something.
Like, whatever. I don't care. Like, I'll do it. I plan
now,
on...
Are you guys doing just sub only, or is there...
No, it's like the ADCC trials rules.
Oh, that's sweet.
It's 3 minutes, no points, 3 minutes, points, 6 minute total match. So I'm cool with it. I mean, I honestly just want to get matches in because before Grappling Industries, like 2 weeks ago, I didn't compete for almost 2 years. And I mean, I finally felt like I competed well.
Like,
nice.
You had a very nice showing, man.
I went 4-1. I took third. I lost to Kevon Gonzalez, brown belt, trained with
legit
Mikey Mann. He's good. Like, I lost 3-0 to him on a guard pass. I thought I could have won that match. I, like, wish I would have done a little better, but I think I competed better than I ever have.
Nice.
Which felt good, and it made me want to compete more.
Yeah.
So I don't mind doing this in-house. Like, to go to the trials, like, no, I'm probably not going to win the fucking ADCC trials. Like, I'm not.
You never know. You never know. That's the, like, crazy part, dude. You never know.
I mean, I know, like, there obviously there's a possibility, but at the same time, realistically, I know I'm probably not going to win. It depends on the brackets. It depends how
it depends on.
Goes.
So, yo, like, I don't know if a butterfly flaps its wings and then fucking it just somehow affects the bracket so that you win. Like, yo, it's crazy. So, like, just like a message to everybody and to, like, yourself, like, yo, like, just do it. Like, why not? You know, like, something might happen, something crazy.
It's kinda...
Like, same thing with this podcast. We're just doing it. Like, you know, like,
yeah, no, there's always a reason to do stuff. And, like,
you heard that, Nike? Just do it.
Cool.
We're saying that shit live. So,
where's our sponsorship?
I saw a Nike video last night, totally off track, about this kid with cerebral palsy. And he
became
Nike's first athlete that has cerebral palsy.
That's awesome.
And I don't even know.
Yo, you could be Nike's second retarded athlete to be sponsored, dude.
That was
roast.
Clearly Fabian who said
dropping that. The hard R's.
Yeah, hard R. Like he like Spanish roll. Yeah.
Wow.
We lost every sponsorship. You're trying to get Nike and you're like,
crap. It's different.
I'm completely against that word. Anyways. But well, yeah, talking about that video, which that was very offensive, Fabian. I was watching it last night and I'm like, am I really in my room alone at night tearing up to this video? I was like, I gotta watch something else.
Oh my god, that's horrible.
Yeah. So yeah, sorry. Completely off track. ADCC trials at Boncho, my man.
Just do it. You know, that's no, but just do it. We were talking about.
Yeah, just, yeah. You gotta just do it. That is true though. You just gotta show up. Like, a lot of it's showing up, especially for competition. Because especially if you care, if you give a shit about the sport, if you give, if you care about the time that you put into all this training and everything, it's not that losing is gonna like. Fuck that. You don't want to lose.
No. I hate losing.
Who wants to lose? And yes,
I'm so competitive.
You either, win or you learn.
Wait.
You can do both.
I want to, like, how competitive are you?
Like, yeah. I depends on the person. Like, sometimes I'm cool. Like, even in training, sometimes I'll be competitive. Like, if someone's, like, in my weight class or something and I'm training with them and we're going hard, like, I want to win the round. Like,
of course, yeah.
I want to win the round. Like I'm my training partner. I love everyone I train with, but I want to win the round.
Yeah, yeah.
And like, if I'm going hard, even with John, like John fucks me up, but like
he fucks us all up.
Yeah, he does. But like when I go with John, like I make it a point to piss him off when I train with him. Like when he's competing and stuff. Like there was a while, like we would train at Pure Heart. Like one of his camps, I think it was for the Onnit. Like he basically we stopped going to the city at that point because he knew he was gonna have Ethan again. He didn't want to train in the same room with him. That's kind of how like the falling out on our part like happened.
Uh-huh.
But like he had no one trained with, basically it was just me and him a lot of the time. So like I would just play, like I honestly like played Ethan's game, and just like that's honestly how I started like using kind of Dela Hiva stuff.
Uh-huh.
I play Ethan's game for him, and I would just like be such an asshole about things. Like I would just violently escape from heel hooks as hard as I can. Like inside Senkaku, I would just start rolling out violently, and every time
he
would tap me still, but like if he'd lose my leg, he'd get so angry and just like stand up and start like pushing me, and like I know how to piss him off. Like before,
that's like the most Brooklyn thing I've ever heard in my life.
We would just get each other, like he would just get mad, like he fucks me up, but he would just get mad at me, like if I just go apeshit hard like defending something. And I would get out sometimes. He gets so mad. He still does get mad.
I've felt something like that. Like, let's say we do like a whole round and he doesn't pass my guard, and then he like last few seconds of the round, or like
setting a pattern where John's gonna fucking pass your guard.
No, he turns it up like sometimes.
Let's say he's on my back and he hasn't like submitted me. He'll fucking throw that spine lock on if it's like 10 seconds left on the round, and like that's what it is. Like if you can, like the first step is just frustrating somebody, and then the second step is like figuring it out from there. I feel like, I mean, I could see it's such a dichotomy, because like when we talk to Quinn about this, like the way he approaches training, and like everyone has their own different approach. Yeah. So like I could see, like if you're being matched up with like your boy, like this is your boy, you know, like one of your best friends, and like you want to give him hard training, but it's also your friend. You also want to fuck with your friend a little bit. You
like,
know,
in
like
training,
I understand.
I don't want to have matches with people I train with or people I'm friends with, because like regardless of maybe I won't beat them, maybe I will, whatever. At the same time, it's like I know I don't want to hurt this person. Like maybe I won't tap them or beat them, whatever. But just in the back of my head, I'm like, I feel bad popping people in training. So I'm like, this is my friend. Like if they don't tap, like, and they're not going to want to tap, I don't know if I'm going to be able to like
we let go like a lot. Yeah. Like dude, we let go all the time.
In training, I won't pop them. But I mean, like if I have to compete against them at the trials,
especially after.
I see what you're saying. So you're competing, like you're thinking about like if you're competing against your friend in the trials and you have him, like, let's say in an inside heel hook, you don't want to pop them as you would
like
the same
I'll finish.
I don't know. Yeah. I don't think
that's on them to tap, but I would feel terrible.
Like, I don't think I would, I don't think I would finish.
It's not worth like,
I don't think I would finish, but it depends.
It would suck because you'd understand how close you were to achieving what you wanted, but I just I don't know.
Like it's different.
I wouldn't be able to.
It's different if it's a choke. I'll put your ass to sleep.
Yeah.
I'm like Sebastian, I'll put you to sleep during training.
You can try.
Actually, but like,
hey, I got slightly put to sleep last night in training by Dan.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh, that's sweet.
Yeah, we were working from back positions at where you started off with one arm in already.
Yeah.
And Dan weighs, he weighs like 203. Let's give him a 203. And he's a strong.
That 3 pounds.
And he's always very controlled. And he didn't mean to put me to sleep. It was that stupid inner dog that I have that's like, don't tap.
Yeah, of course.
Don't tap.
We all have that.
In the last training session of the day, like just working. And then I felt like he had just the one hand grip and he's squeezing and I'm like, I can fight this. And then I'm grabbing the hand and I'm go to pull down and I'm like, I can't fight this. And I'm like, no, I can't. And then like everything just closes and I go to tap, but like I go out.
I go out
because I feel myself go out and I guess my hand lands on him. So he lets go. And I just like come right back in and I'm like, oh, I just got put out. And like I look over and Dan didn't realize and I was like, good.
How did that feel though? Like, did you?
It was really quick. I didn't get put out.
Was it like a euphoric one, or was it?
I'm not gonna lie, it felt pretty good.
Because there's like
mom is so disappointed right now.
There's like two different types of chokes. There's like the blood choke and the air choke. So blood chokes are supposed to be the ones that feel euphoric. The air chokes, like you feel like you're dying. You know, like you're like that one's like the worst one.
I feel like you've learned this from. Just relationships,
No. It's my old sensei. Well, not my old sensei. My sensei Krishna. He was teaching me the north south choke, and he's like, it's not an air choke, it's a blood choke. So this choke should be euphoric. You have to target the arteries in the back of the neck, and like
Krishna's the man, dude.
Yeah. But that's how I learned the difference.
Like, yeah,
he's like one of these guys who's very philosophical about everything in jiu-jitsu.
Yeah,
and I like seeing those aspects. I like when Eddie would talk about grabbing a wrist.
Yeah.
I
was like, I've never heard anybody put it that way. You know? I felt literally.
It's so much detail.
And it's so funny because I'd go train there and I'd leave and I'd just be like, did I really just like? I was like, I love this.
It's thing. So much little detail in terms of like from being like a very very good guy to being like a world class guy. Yeah. It's just little details that change everything and like just
that's what
obviously I don't
details
know,
and timing. Not,
yeah.
But I think the better you get, the smaller the details, the more important.
I just know from being around those guys and like seeing how like Eddie, how methodical he is with things.
Insane.
Like it's ridiculous.
Insane. I think his approach to jiu-jitsu is my absolute favorite approach to jiu-jitsu. I don't think I can approach it that way, but his like I would love to be able to approach it that way.
Why not? I mean, we're trying. Like, yeah, we all have the same...
But I think everyone approaches things, like, the way you approach math. Is
Eddie was also a fucking, like, scientist.
Also, yeah, Eddie's... So he has, like, a degree in philosophy, right?
I don't think philosophy...
I think it was physics.
He has, like... I think he's, like... He just has to hand in, like, one paper, and he has, like, a PhD or something.
Well, I mean, regardless of that, just... Spending time studying physics, you know, being able to look at things from a different perspective.
And he's, like, obsessed to a different level. Like, he sits at home and, like, drills and, like,
and
has a dummy
watching
and, like,
videos,
watching video. Like,
watching, like instructionals and shit.
Eddie is the most, like, obsessed person I've ever met.
Wow, which, I mean, look at the results, you know?
Yeah.
No,
yeah,
Eddie helped me, like, a ridiculous amount.
Yeah,
just,
man. Even the little bit of time that I got to spend in that class while he was teaching, it was just, like, you knew how valuable that class was being in that room, you know?
Yeah.
You knew because, look, that room had, like, 35 people. It's a 9 a.m. Monday and Wednesday class. And
35 people, chill, dude.
No,
dude, at one
it
point
did.
You show up to
really?
The house. Yeah.
When all the hipsters were showing up?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, I remember. Yeah. As soon as you said hipsters, I just,
like,
eight
like,
tatted up people just popped
like
into my head.
10
yeah.
to, like, 10, like, of us.
Yeah.
And, like, 25 hipsters.
Yeah, man. Yeah, like,
but,
the main Shire group.
And then,
before
like,
the Shire.
The rest of the hipsters, but with
before the rings were made.
Before the war started.
Before the war started.
I was lucky enough, though, like, when John and I left the city, Elon left the city with us, and Eddie also left the city.
Elon definitely left the city because he was trying to hide up some corruption of his, you know?
But
beating up some person.
At one point, it was basically, like, the four of us, and, like, Tony B came with us.
Tony B wasn't really on the podcast next week.
He wasn't really training in the city much, but like when we were at Pure Heart, like we literally do sessions with like the five of us. So and then we like a few months later, once Pure Heart started, like it was at the end of Pure Heart when it was dying down, and then we started going to ITC before like that EBI stuff. And we were going out. Me and John were like,
fun, man.
That was fun.
And that was my first taste of training with you guys. And I was like, this is what I want to do for the rest of my life.
It was literally like that same group of people plus like you and Quinn.
Yeah.
And that was like the group there at ITC. And then we go to Bayside. Like Eddie wouldn't go to Bayside as much, but it was mostly like me and John would go to get our extra training. It'd be me, John, Frank, Vinny, and like a few Nicolo, like the Sarah guys would come.
Wow, that's awesome.
So it would be like those were our two training sessions. And we were kind of all over the place for a while, and like I would just go wherever John would go, and that John's basically like my coach, even though he's like doesn't fucking coach, but you know, it's also my fault because I don't go to his morning classes.
No, man, like even like Quinn's my main coach, and I consider John my second coach. I texted him the other day after I won the Naga belt. Let me just throw that in there again. No big deal, you know. You're not a legit grappler until you win a Naga belt. Whatever.
I must not be legit at all.
Right next to his bed at all times.
Yeah, I wish I would have been able to keep that Naga belt. But I texted him after. I was like, finally won a Naga belt. Thanks, coach. And he's like, send me the video I sent to him. But, yeah, man, John's the man. And he's it's his approach to jiu-jitsu is great, too, because he's not, like, as philosophical with the positions, you know? Sometimes, you know, I just need somebody to dumb it down
for me. Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Explain it in the simplest.
I'm like,
yeah.
I'm like, I'm pretty dumb. So what do you mean by reverse inside wedge?
Yeah, I mean, he's gotten a lot better at like coaching people and like helping them understand things.
Yeah, you guys say that, but I'm like, I've heard you guys say that. You're like, yeah, he's gotten a lot better. I'm like, I've never had a
no. Like, he used to be fucking awful. At
really?
Like, because Pure Heart was his first coaching thing. Like, and that was like 2 years ago when he started coaching there, and. Mm-hmm. He was, I think, a newish brown belt at the time.
Okay.
And, like, he'd never coached before, so he didn't, like, he was just starting. Like, he had to learn, like, how to coach, you know?
Yeah, of course. So I have that same problem. Yeah. Like, it's like, hard.
He never coached anyone, so, like, he kind of started with, like, he had his morning class and the kids' class. So it was a lot of, like.
John was teaching the kids' class?
He was teaching kids.
Yeah, but he had, like, 2-3 kids. Like.
But still.
Yeah, like.
Were they teens or were they like little kids? Showing
them one of them was like, it was for the most part, it was like two people. It was this like 16, 17 year old kid and his little sister who was like 10. And she was like pretty good for like a little kid. Like John taught her like legitimate stuff. He has an easier time, I think, at least before teaching one on one than like kind of like to a small group or one on one than he did to like a bigger group of people. Now I think he's more used to it. But at the same time, like, he had to learn how to coach, and like, he would always show legit stuff. He just had to learn how to like break it down to where everyone understands it, like to where like the white belt understands it, and like, I don't know, to like where beginners understand it, and like the advanced guys are like, all right, yeah, here
it works out also here.
Yeah, because his classes are always so mixed. Like, he'll have like 3 white belts in the room, but then have like purple and brown belts, black belts in the room. Because everyone wants to go learn from him, especially like after EBI and stuff. Like,
yeah, for sure. Like, that was a crazy, that was crazy. I remember watching you guys there. I was driving back. There was a huge blizzard hitting the East Coast when that happened. It was a huge blizzard, and we had been working. Quinn and I had worked in Naga, and we were driving back down from Boston. And Quinn's driving in this like Volvo that he has. Thankfully, it's a Volvo. But we're trying to watch the EBI. Yeah, we're trying to watch the EBI as we're driving back through this blizzard, and we're just watching John go in there and just wreck everybody, you know. And he just in there, and we're like,
it was
cheering, and then we cheer, and then the car starts drifting. And we're like, ah!
We're like, it was literally
like, it was wild, man. We like at one point we were like, it was one of the craziest experiences because that blizzard was insane and driving through it.
Yeah.
So eventually he wins it. We pull over at this rest stop, and one of my friends who's out there, he runs BJJ World. He was covering the event. I FaceTime him, and he's right next to you guys, and I go, yo, pass the phone to John. And he passes
me and John on FaceTime with you guys. You I'm like, John. What the fuck is going
and
on?
And John's like all over the place. He got the belt. And Quinn and I are like, yeah!
Oh, my God.
In a Dunkin' that Donuts hole. In a rest station. And then you guys were like, oh, what's up? And we started, it was hilarious,
that whole thing
dude.
Was nuts. That whole trip.
So you went to Cali with John. Yeah, what happened, dude? Like,
and the first question I have is, how much In-N-Out did you guys eat?
I think we went there like 3 times in 3 days.
Oh, man. In-N-Out.
Yo, I crushed.
Oh.
I ate so much food. Like, I had animal-style double-doubles.
Oh, yeah,
fries. Like, I was just so fat. And, like, I think I gained like 8 pounds.
Whenever whenever I travel to a state that has In-N-Out, I legit come back weighing like 163.
Yo.
Yeah, and I'm walking around right now like 152,
153.
But
oh, dude, I don't want to see how much I weigh right now.
You don't because I'm on point. I don't know if you saw
I have flabs. I don't have abs. They're just flabby abs. Yo, as soon as I saw you doing pull-ups, I was like, I'm going to do some push-ups, and I just laid in my bed. And I went to sleep. Awesome. I'm not even joking. Yeah. I wanted to do push-ups so bad, but I didn't.
I'm like, damn, the video only looks like I did three. I was like, but I did only do three.
Oh, my God.
No.
That's hilarious.
I was on my method. Anyways, change the subject. But
Oh, yeah, how was the Cali trip? I forgot.
So, EBI, like, Eddie was supposed to be in the EBI. We all know that. Eddie was going to do it. We were all training for it. Like, we went, like I was saying, we were training at ITC. We were training at a...
He was on fire, dude.
Yeah, we're training ITC every day in the morning and then going to Bayside in the afternoons, getting two training sessions in. Eddie was training other places, too. I think he was training at Motion as well. And Eddie was supposed to go, and, like, Eddie gets nuts before he competes. He's like, oh, man, I don't know, like, Wade and stuff, blah, blah, blah. And, like...
He gets nerves like everybody. He's still human.
Yeah, no, Eddie's, like, freaks out just because of how, like... Just his mind, like, I understand, and, like, I freak out, too. Like, it's definitely
human.
Understandable.
Yeah.
But, like, he was freaking out, but, like, he was going to make weight, and he's like, all right, I'm going. So, me and John, we got flight to Cali, because Eddie didn't have anyone to go with him. It was just him and Atavia. So, like, we were going to go out there so we could train with him. We're like, why not? We'll go to California. We'll go be in Eddie's corner, train with him, just to be there for him, because he didn't really have anyone. So, we get our flight. We go out. And then, like, Eddie, we were going to get out there the day before, Eddie, because it was when the flights were the cheapest. We took, like, Spirit out there. It was super
I fucking hate Spirit.
Spirit sucks. Dude, Spirit's wild. It's, like, literally, you sit down
they charge
and you're
you
like,
for everything.
Yeah, you're, like, sit down and you're, like, is this a cardboard box?
We just...
And they're, like, no.
We just packed up. We packed up, like, one book bag each and just shoved everything in there so we didn't get charged.
Dude, like, they charge so much for that.
They're like, what color is your book bag? You're like, red. They're like, oh, we got a red book bag.
$40.
Yeah, $45.
It's too bright. The
we
birds are attracted
to
it.
On the cheap. So, like, I said, we also went out early because I set up a seminar for John. So
oh, that's what's up.
Yeah, so, like, the flights didn't wind up costing anything. Yeah,
that's what's up. Wow.
So, basically, we went out there. We were going to get out there the day before Eddie. We went out, and there was, like... Eddie got sick, apparently, so we weren't sure if he was like, I'm really sick. I'm going to try to just get through it and come. And he was supposed to get out there Friday, and then I think it was Thursday, and then Friday he, like, maybe we were out there either Wednesday or Thursday. I don't remember exactly. And then John gets a call. I think it was Kaplan who called him, and he's like, Eddie's not coming. Like, Eddie's sick, and he's telling Eddie Bravo to put you in.
What the fuck?
And then the next morning, like... The morning, I think it was, no, it would have been Thursday he got the call. And I think that was the first day we were out there, maybe the second day. And then that morning, like, he officially, like, he's talking to Eddie. Eddie's like, dude, I have the flu, like, bad. I'm not going to make it out. I'm going to tell them to put you in. But we had no, like, definite, like, that John was in. Mm-hmm. And then one of the producers of EBI was like, it was early in the morning the next day, like, the day before EBI. And they're like, we can't get in contact with Eddie Bravo, but we have to make this announcement now. I'm making an executive decision. You're in.
Oh, my God.
Like, so
dude.
I'm literally, like, in the hotel taking a picture of John so they can use it for, like, the EBI.
The poster,
like,
yeah.
You know, they use the pictures and stuff to, like, announce that he's in. I'm taking a picture on his phone of him, like, against a white wall. And then from there, it was just nonstop. Like, we went.
Moving.
We trained. Yeah. They had to do an interview with him beforehand at, like, a hotel. And then we, like, went to weigh-ins or whatever.
At a hotel. And then, at a CD hotel. They fucked them. Then.
Like, all right, we'll meet you at the Knights Inn. It's like,
yeah. Oh, we've only got the room for 3 hours, so you better hurry.
It was actually, like, a super nice hotel. We went over there, did the interview, the weigh-ins and everything. I think we're the next day because I think it was – I can't remember. I think it was day of weigh-ins, like, in the morning, and then competed later. Yeah, I believe so.
Sure?
Yeah. I'm pretty sure.
Yeah.
I think it was morning of weigh-ins, but it was 45, so John was on weight. But we were, like, we trained and everything, went out there. Kaplan flew out to also be in the corner. It was me and him cornering John. And, like, the whole time beforehand, he was, like, freaking out, like, just having, like, a panic attack.
Ooh, Calestine, right?
Like,
oh, my God,
out,
like, yeah. He gets those
nerves.
Doing
outside, like, crying, like, hiding, and, like, coloring in his coloring book. And then every time, like, yo, He's been better lately, but like when he like first started taking big matches, like the Sean Applegate match was like his first like big super fight.
Uh-huh.
Yo, this kid like pops my ankles backstage and like almost breaks me.
No way.
Yo, and then before EBI, like before EBI and before Kasai, he hasn't been as bad. Like he's been like used to it, I guess now.
Yeah.
So he's just been warming up like an old person, and then like will kind of do breaking mechanics, but slowly. He used to like fucking almost break my leg backstage all the time. Before EBI, he's violently outside heel looking me in like the warm up area. And everyone's like looking over, like, cause I'm screaming, tap, tap, like, cause he's violently bridging on like heel hooks. And everyone's just looking over, like Ashley Williams is looking over, like, like scared. Yeah,
like, that's like the equivalent of like a striker hitting pads, like fucking like a monster. Like, you just hear tap.
Yeah. Like, I'm just screaming. Like, he just violently heel-hooking me. And then we go out. The first match was Junie.
Yeah.
John had two matches with him in one day, like, 2 years before. And he was, like, 1-1. One was, like, a judge's decision. And then John, like, inverted heel-hooked Junie and, like, popped his knee the second match the same day.
Shit.
They were, like, both purple belts at the time. Or John might have been a blue belt still. I think he was a blue belt, man. And he just got his purple belt. This is, like, the first time I ever competed, like, probably, like, 3.5 years ago now.
That's wild.
3 years ago. So, him and Junie have a match. John ends it pretty quickly, wins by heel hook. And then another rematch is the second match. It's Jason Hayden, who he had at Zapatero. And, like, that Zapatero was rough. And, like, I was there for the Zapatero, too. Jason, like, sprained both of John's ankles just with, like, Estima locks and, like, weird shit.
Really?
And it was, like, a tough match. John, like, almost tapped him in the last seconds and lost in overtime on ride time. And he's, like, freaking out about the match with Jason because he's like, this guy hurt me last time, like, and then goes out there, beats him in 30 seconds, and he's
Holy shit.
Yeah,
and then goes out.
That was when we were in that car, in the car with the Blizzard, and we're like, oh, this is a match that we're gonna
like he see. Was
because John had mentioned it himself. He's like, I had a match before.
Jason's super good.
Yeah, like, Jason's
he is
a great grappler, and his brother too.
Like,
Josh.
No one talks about him, but like,
I mean,
dude took second at the trials.
Yeah, Gracie like, Fishhawk down there is legit.
He took second at the trials, lost to Justin Rader on like a takedown or something.
Yeah, and Justin Rader's
but
yeah, when he got went in and he just fucking hit that entry and that finish so quick, we're just like, nah, it's his.
That was just the shit we were working on all camp, and he just went in,
nice,
hit him, tapped him, and I'm like, all right, like,
all right,
and then like we're
on to something.
We're just trying to get him hot. Like, John is someone like, you just have to get him, like, hyped up. Like, because he doesn't really hear much of cornering and stuff. Like, he's not someone who needs, like, the most technical cornering. Like, yeah, sometimes, like, you tell him something, he'll hear you, and he'll, like, be like, all right, like, just something small. Like, if, because obviously in the heat of competition, sometimes you, like, aren't doing everything perfect.
Yeah.
But he executes when he competes, but he has to be, like, pissed off and mad a lot of times before he goes in there to kill someone.
So that's why he has Kaplan.
Like, Kaplan just pisses him off, so he gets mad. And then, like, I was trying to hype him up, like, telling him, like, before the match, I'm like, that's 10 grand. Like, you have no fucking money. You're going to go home and be a loser. I literally told him that before the finals.
Fuck,
like,
yeah.
After he beat Davila, too. Yeah. I'm like, that's $15,000. Are you going to lose to this fucking guy? Like, you're going to lose to him and go home with no money. You're going to be broke as shit. Like, you have no money. You're going to go home and be broke, and you're probably never going to want jiu-jitsu again. He's like, I'm not fucking losing this fucking guy. And, like, I'm just screaming at him, like, getting him hype. And, like, he just goes out there. I'm like, John, this is, like, you go home with money or you go home with nothing. Like, do you want to be the EBI champion or you want to be a fucking second-place loser? And he just goes out there, has the match with Gio.
Oh, my God, that match was insane, dude.
The worst, like, Gio had, like, wars. Like, Gio had a war with, what's-his-face, Domingos before. And, like, I don't know how he pulled that one off. Like,
how he got out of that arm triangle?
He was getting beat up that match. And then just, like, wins in overtime. Like, he was losing in overtime, too. Just pulls out the arm bar.
Yo, fuck.
And, like,
Gio's legit, man.
They gave him, like, 45 minutes to recover, though.
Really?
Because he was, like, puking in the bat. Like, someone told me that he was, like, puking in the bathroom before the match. And, like, they just kept going to commercials. And everyone's just sitting there, like, why is this taking so long? John's like, come on. Like, get this guy up. Let's go. We're having this match.
Holy shit.
Like, they waited so long to have the finals match. And then they just went at it. And, like, that overtime was crazy, too. Like, everything we worked on, like, I'm screaming. Like, I was pretty much a main corner for the overtime just because, like, I knew everything we worked on. And, like, I was in the room every day. So, like, I'm trying to, like, coach John through, like, the overtime sequence and stuff. And then that last armbar Gio put on, and then John's shoulder went. Like,
yeah.
As he got
out. My God. So what happened? Did you see his shoulder go?
No, but, like, you could, like, the armbar was, like, it was, like, weird. It was,
he
like
switched a, to that, like, shoulder lock.
Yeah, it was, yeah, like, a shoulder lock, and John was, like, clearing, and he said his, like, his shoulder just out, like, ripped. He just was, like, on the floor, and then he, like, they raise his hand,
and he's, like, ah! He's just, like, immediately he grabs his arm,
I know, it's insane.
That's crazy, dude. He's just, like, he's so just, like, fuck it, I'm, he was just, like, I'm going home with that money.
He's, like, my shoulder, he's, like, I have two.
And that was, like, his good shoulder, because the other shoulder got popped out, like, before that. Like, he didn't compete for, like, 8 months in between, because at the Kumite, his shoulder popped out when he did, like, the 155, and that was his other shoulder.
Like, yo, it's like, it's like in the movies when somebody's, like, in handcuffs and they break their own thumb to get out. He's like, he's like, I'm going home, like, with that money.
At that point, like, it's 15 grand and you're EBI champion or not, and you just have to get out.
And left, announced in 24 hours notice and shit, you know? Yeah, like, just came in there and
worked. No, it was, like, that was so fucking crazy. Like, we just worked so hard, like, leading up to that camp, and, like, every day, like, and all the stuff before that, like, no one took the kid, like, seriously. Like, he didn't get, I don't think, the credit he deserved. Like, he won literally everything locally, and even, like, not even locally, like, just, like, the Onnit, Zapatero, finishers, Kumite, like, literally won pretty much everything. I think he's lost, like, three fucking matches,
dude. And he, like, I think it's finally time that he's been getting, you know, he's been getting the results. No, I think this match with Gianni was the final thing. At least people who didn't, maybe the crowd that Gianni brings in, because Gianni's crowd is a very different crowd than the Savoli crowd. So I think when you see that match and you see that Gianni, look at Gianni, he went the next, he won the New York, the open, pro, I think.
And he won Pans.
And then he won Pans, like, Nogi Pans, you know? And obviously everyone knows Gianni's legit, but look at that match, you know? It was a... I really enjoyed that match.
Love that match.
John had three really good entries. One of them was tight.
Johnny's super tough. Super nice dude, by the way, too. Like, I respect that guy. Like, he came over, just shook everyone's hand. That's like, he's Dice was getting emotional. He's like, why are you crying, man? He's one of us. Like, Johnny was super nice.
What do you think, like, he meant by that?
He just meant, like, he's, like...
He's part of the jiu-jitsu community, you know?
Jiu-jitsu community, like... No, like that. I think something like that, at least by those lines. I don't know exactly.
Like, kind of like, and he's like,
Gianni also came up in Renzos too. So,
That's it's crazy. There's so much.
I think
history.
He just kind of meant like, I think he kind of meant like he belongs.
Yeah,
like as like the high level guys. I know.
I saw that video of Daisuke crying. I was like, dude. It was
can,
like
that's how you can tell someone about really cares.
Dice really cares about like. All of like his guys, like he cares a lot.
Yeah.
But this next Kasai is gonna be nuts.
I hope Calestine comes out screaming again. You remember the Calestine scream, dude? That shit gets me so hyped.
Like I was backstage.
So did he like he was he just yelling all the time?
Yeah, like a little Dice banshee. Getting him hype because Dice is just like Dice is screaming and then John screams. And it was nuts. Yo, I am so hyped for this Kasai. Like,
oh my god,
that's what I meant by the. Like the respect he deserves. That's an ADCC bracket. That bracket right there.
Honestly,
that's
trials. If he wins, that's like, trials right there. I honestly think he wins that. Like, I think he wins that. He should have an invite to ADCC. Yeah, I think it's ridiculous.
They should buy him a first class fucking ticket. Though.
I think it's absolutely ridiculous if he wins that tournament and doesn't get an invite to ADCC. I don't care who else is getting invited. Like,
but I don't know, man. I don't think at this point, if like, dude, if he wins that, like, look, he won the Gianni match and he got automatically put into that. So like. There seems right now to be a pattern.
Yeah, there's like momentum. He's coming.
Yeah. But like, look at that tournament though. Like, look who everyone who's in it. Like, ADCC, like, medalists, like, multiple medalist guys.
Get invites.
Everyone in that tournament.
People who are going to get invites are in that bracket.
I think everyone in that tournament, aside from John and Ashley Williams, have been to ADCC before.
Holy shit. Yeah.
Gio took fourth, I think.
I don't know. Bruno Frazzato.
Paolo. Gianni.
Tanquinho.
And Ethan.
Dude. And Ethan, yeah.
All those guys have been to ADCC, except for John and Ashley Williams. Like, and honestly, if you beat those guys, I don't care about the rule set, whatever. It's a different rule set, but it's close. Like, it's no gi.
It's jiu-jitsu. Bro, get your dirty shoes.
I'm comforter, bro.
It's no gi.
Yeah, that's perfectly fine, of course. That's common sense.
I didn't even realize. Like, it's no gi. It's a very similar rule set. Like, should have an invite. Like, you win that, should have an invite. I don't care. Like,
oh, absolutely. But we'll see how politics plays.
We'll see.
Yeah.
I honestly don't think that he would not. I think he'd automatically get invited.
I think he deserves it after that. Like, come on. Those guys are the top. Like, no gi. Like, it's very. Like, who else is, like, especially that weight class? Like, who is above those guys? Like,
no one.
Aside from, what's his face? I don't know how I'm blanking on his name. Cabrinha.
Oh, yeah, Cabrinha. Yeah.
Like, Cabrinha is the top guy at 145, ADCC, obviously, no, ADCC. Yeah, but, yeah. Like, who's ahead of, like, everyone else there? Like, those are all the top guys. Like, how do you not have an invite for winning that? That makes no sense to me.
We'll see. Well, it's getting close. I'm excited.
Awesome. I'm excited
and
for that.
Speaking of that, we're going to go to the Shire.
We have to train
right now.
Shit, I'm so hungry.
Yeah, we're going to get some coffee or something on the way for sure, because my addiction to coffee is full-blown at this point.
You drove here?
No, I took the train.
All right, so come. Yeah, yeah. We'll hop
in. We have Chris Paliuka.
Wow, I completely forgot how to say it.
Twice in a row.
I was so happy you said it.
No one could say my last name right, ever.
Paliuka?
But I don't blame them because it doesn't look anything like it sounds. Yeah. But it's Italian.
What's the G for?
I got it twice in a row.
It's Italian.
Oh, G's moving silence.
Fucking gangster, dog.
Thank you, guys.
Shout out.
Yeah, no doubt, man.
Direct anybody towards anything?
I don't fucking know. Like, I don't...
Cool. Follow us at the Four Stringers.
Yeah, come follow us at the Shire B... Well, at Shire BJJ.
Talk over each other's
perfect. I mean, yeah. You can follow me on Instagram. It's at Chris Paliuka, just my name, but, like...
Good luck spelling that.
Good luck. Good luck. I'm not even going to spell it out. I really don't care about social media, whatever.
Yeah. Every guy in a relationship says that. Yeah. But anyways, guys, this has been another episode. Please... Like, we're doing the Chris D'Elia.
Oh, yeah. Like and subscribe. Smash the donate button.
We're about to get everything out on iTunes, Spotify, YouTube.
Oh, we're doing that?
Working on that, yeah. If right now...
We want video up on this shit. I don't know how I'm going to make it work.
Let us know. I will...
Yeah, just record the video. Like, hook up a camera right there.
Why don't you just make the fucking laptop record us while it's...
Because what kind of quality is that?
Booty, dude, you know?
That looks like a fucking...
And then I'll put my iPad over there, and then we'll have, like, three camera angles.
Well, guys, we're going to work on the future. If you want to hear anything...
If you got any ideas, DM us about
it. Yeah, the Chris D'Elia effect. Guys. If you like this, share it. Please, share it. Share it with your mom. Share it with your dad. Share it with people in the jiu-jitsu community. All right, guys.
All right. I love you, my babies.
Love you guys. Don't click the donate button on baby.
Smash it. Smash the donate.